Thanks, Daniel, for that lovely introduction. What Sascha Spoon just told you, be curious, be engaged, and try to fight for a better world. That's a good appeal. The question is it a lost case? I try to convince you a little bit with real-world data that it's not a lost case and that it's a good decision to be here at a university. So I'm talking about turning points in the sense of what is changing people's mindsets around the world, based on data from the World Value Survey and also from Our World in Data, which is something that I recommend everyone to consult whenever you do a fact-checking exercise. Well, what's going on in the world when we talk about people's mindset? Many philosophers have argued that, yes, humanity is making technological progress, quite a lot, but our mindsets do not keep pace with that change because we are still entrapped in our tribal psychology that has been hardwired into us in our 99% of our historic time that we spent as hunter-gatherer tribal societies. The tribal instinct is indeed there, and sometimes very pronounced and strong. We see it always when we look at the right-wing extremist spectrum of the political scale. You recognize it when in-group favoritism is appealed to, like America First, or what we just hear since a week, Italy First, from the mouth of Giorgia Meloni. So part of the authoritarian instinct is a very strong in-group favoritism, very closely related to out-group discrimination. We also see it in our surveys. When, for instance, in our regular surveys that we do, for instance, in Russia, 75% of Russians say that they like democracy, but the same 70% also say that they also like very much the idea of having a strong, quote, a strong ruler who does not have to bother with parliaments, elections, critical media, and a justice system that is independent. That's one part of our nature. But there's another part, and that's the opposite. This is what I call the emancipatory drive that is linked to our brain and to our capacity to think for ourselves. When that element kicks in, people no longer want to be remote controlled by external domination, what to think and what to do. And when that happens, this is a shield against the authoritarian instinct. And we get mentality growth if we get into that mode. Actually, the mission of this university is, in a sense, to trigger that emancipatory drive. But what's the state of humanity when we think of these two opposite modes of mindset operation? Where are we? Are we moving? Are we changing? Yes, we are. And in order to make the case that it's not a lost case, I will show you a couple of snapshots from our data. We start in the year 1960 and we end up in the year 2017. Unfortunately, the slide is scrambled. But the basic story that I want to show you here is that is a global average. So we see the number of years of school attendance in the one curve that is going up, and we see in the other curve the female fertility rate, which is the number of births per woman on average. So this is a global average we see for every year from 1962 or 17. Countries are weighted here in this global average by population size. So what's happening in China and India weighs more than what's happening in Andorra or Iceland to create that global average. But what you get here is a tremendous transition in people's reproductive investment from fertility to education. Some of you might be familiar with what social biologists call the difference between R and K strategies. So there are species that are around that produce many offspring, huge amounts of offspring, but there is no or almost no parental care. Like think of fish, turtles, whatever comes to mind, insects, producing many offspring, little parental care. So enough offspring will survive to guarantee that the species will sustain. The opposite strategy is to produce fewer offspring and to do a lot of parental care. One guiding principle of this is whether you are quantity breeding or quality building is the brain capacity of the species. Because the species with a lot of brain capacity have a lot to teach their offspring, and the offspring need a lot of time in order to be socialized in taking on a functioning role in society. Well, to a certain extent, we see this also, this principle also applies to humankind. Where fertility rates are high, say like on average 5 to 6 births per woman over her life course, school attendance is low. And vice versa, where school attendance, schooling years are numerous, fertility rates are low. So this is an inverse relationship that existed in this inversity ever since we have measured it. But humanity as a whole is shifting to a situation where we have a transition from quantity breeding to quality building. So more and more emphasis is paid into individuals' skill acquisition and their brain capacity. We can describe this as a huge process of cognitive mobilization. More and more people are learning to use their brain capacity, and that is a good precondition to solve problems. Now, different parts in the world are on different stages in this process, but this process is happening everywhere. This is for the Western countries. Western countries have already left the turning point, which was way back when the two lines were crossing each other. That was somewhere after the Second World War. If we look to the post-Soviet space, they just crossed the turning point or the crossing point in the early 1990s. And if you look at the Global South, they are just before, in front of approaching that crossing point. So, what is driving this? Why is this happening? Why is humanity transiting from quantity breeding to quality building? Well, science. Progress in medicine and related fields are reducing mortality rates almost everywhere in the world, except for a handful of spaces that are shrinking in size and in number. Mortality rates are shrinking. Life expectancies are expanding, again, almost everywhere in the world. And this is doing something also with our mindsets, because if we have a wider time horizon into the future, that we take it for granted in Germany that almost everyone gets 80 years or can hope to get at that age, that changes your time perspective to a tremendous extent. And then people start to think about investments that have, as economists used to say, a delay of gratification, meaning that the investment pays off at a later stage in your life. Education is one of those investments, and probably the smartest one. Now, this is probably the most important diagram that a first semester student of any university in the world should see, because it shows that education has an enlightening spark, no matter where it happens. What you see on the horizontal scale is people are staggered in terms of what level of education they have received. We start from people that have received no education at all, or only a few years of primary school, and then interrupted maybe because of child labor or other things, all the way up to people who have completed tertiary level education, which is a university degree. And then we look into different regions in the world. We call it culture zones. So Indic East, for instance, is South Asia, basically speaking. So it's India, Pakistan, Bangladesh. Islamic East would be countries in the MENA region, so Middle East, Northern Africa, and so on and so forth. We see everywhere where people have higher levels of education, their emancipatory drive is triggered. So the emancipative values are stronger. Well, a short note, what these values are measuring is it's based on questions that we ask in opinion polls and surveys. Emancipative values emphasize, or if someone is strong in emancipative values, this person emphasizes self-determination in what she or he is doing and thinking. And secondly, equality of opportunities. Everyone should have a chance, the same chance, no matter what sex, no matter what race, no matter what age, no matter what religion. So freedom of choice and equality of opportunities is what these values are measuring. And now we see that education all over the world is giving rise to these values. This is, in a sense, fundamentally surprising, because education systems around the world differ in almost anything you can think of. Curricula are different, quality of teaching is probably different, subject matter is different, and also the values that certain regimes try to infuse into people's mindsets might differ. Autocrats have no interest in enculturing emancipative values, because then people start to question unconsented, arrogated authority, because they don't want to be remote controlled in what to think and to believe. So this is very bad news for China's neo-totalitarian model of a perfectly orchestrated society governed by a social credit system. We see it also in our Chinese surveys, and this is not just Chinese students who go to Western universities. Education, in some sense, no matter what subject, no matter what regime is operating that educational system, in some sense, it triggers our capacity to think for ourselves, no matter what you study. So seeing this, you should be happy to be an attendant of a university. And if you're attending some of my classes, I will further encourage you in that attitude. I'm jumping to something else. This is also important. Now, and also not good news for countries like Russia or China, who are challenging the liberal Western order and liberal democracy. People get happy for very different reasons. Many roads lead to Rome, as one uses to say. But certain things are changing as the emancipatory drive is triggered. What gets us to happiness is changing. We know from many surveys that we have that religious people are usually happier than people who are secular. That's a proven fact that you can find in every country. People who are saying on a scale from 1 to 10, 10, God is very important in my life, tend to be happier than people who are saying 1. There's good reasons for that. Religion is a source of comfort, especially in a world that seems to be dangerous and threatening. And then, of course, religious people tend to be more, they also have sort of religion is also a source of certainty that in the end, things will turn out positively, salvation. Life goes on after I'm dying. So it's plausible that religion is important. There is another factor, however, that is also important. We ask people on a scale from 1 to 10, how much choice do you think you have over the way your life turns out. 1, I have no choice at all. And 10, I'm imperfectly in control. I'm in the driver's seat of my life. And this felt freedom, this perceived freedom, has also everywhere, all over the world, a positive impact on people's happiness. So people report to be more happy when they think they have greater control, more choice over their lives. Now, both forces are kind of on opposite ends with each other, kind of competing for people's happiness. But what we see very clearly in our data is that as emancipative values are growing stronger, as fertilities drop and school attendance rises and mortalities fall and life expectancies expand, freedom becomes more and more and more important in relative terms for how happy people feel. If this is true, and our data show it is, this is an evolutionary force of nature that operates strongly in favor of the liberal democratic model of society and strongly in disfavor of the neo-totalitarian model of society, of a perfectly orchestrated society by a social credit system which assumes that humans are insects without a brain. Apparently, this is not the case. So what I want to say with this, there is reason to be courageous, there is reason to be hopeful, and there is reason to study, to educate yourself, and to get more knowledge. It is not a lost case. I hope this was convincing. Thank you for the attention.